Well, good morning. I up in front, we ran out of communion, regular communion, so gluten-free was the, and those taste pretty good, I want you to say. But gluten-free communion elements were given, and but I want to also say, I think we were talking about the walking tacos. I think all of the sauce, all the seasoning is gluten-free, all right? So if you have any concerns about that, please do not allow that to be the thing that stops you. It smells good and it tastes good, trust me. Okay, I tried some. Right? Confessing it, but it's out there. All right. Well, we're now back to regular church apparel for me up here. I have finished up, at least where we have finished up, our series for the summer called The Summer in the Minors, and so no more baseball jerseys until next summer, when we're working through some prophets again in that way. But I wanted to just encourage you to open your Bible, if you would, to 2 Samuel. And I think it's always good to have the Word open there in front of you, whether it be on a tablet, your phone, what is called a codex. No, none of you have scrolls that I know of, but we... maybe you do, I don't know. But the reality is, this is the Word of God, and this is we work through the Bible expositionally, expository preaching, as we go through it, because we want to preach the whole counsel of God here. And so that we're back in 2 Samuel, and I want to give a little bit of a synopsis as we're working through this together. This person, David, who showed up in 1 Samuel, is now king. He was Samuel, who the book is named after. Samuel was a prophet, and he had been called of God to lead the people. They did not want him. I think he was too much, he was too Bible-y for them. He wanted a king. They wanted a king like the other nations. And as a result of that, they said to Samuel, hey, we'd like a king. And basically, Samuel was a little upset about that. And God says to him, no, don't let that bother you. They're not rejecting you, they're rejecting me. And understand that. I had a good talk with somebody this week that reminded me that sometimes the things that you and I will share, they're not rejecting us, they're rejecting the Lord. I want to be gracious as I share truth and stuff, but there'll be times where there'll be a rejection, and it isn't necessarily you. It's the Lord, and so that's what happened. And so they got the king that they asked for, Saul. They got their first king, was named Saul, good-looking, tall, the kind of guy that, you'd be on the covers of magazines, that type of thing, and Saul means you asked for it. And that's what they got. And he ended up being very carnal, to the point where when he can't even, he's not obeying God, and it gets to the point where he has to be set aside. But even then, there's this young man, this boy, David, that is coming on the scene, and we hear about him defeating a giant in Goliath, and being a person that is successful. God is with him, and the Bible says that he's a man after God's own heart. And you'd think he gets anointed, and so he'd be king immediately, and that's not how God works sometimes. He has to put us through a process of refining us and taking away everything that looks like you and me and making us more conformed to the image of God's Son, Jesus Christ. His goal in us, and sometimes we can only learn that through pain, is to make us look like Jesus. And so David, this is happening, and ultimately Saul dies, and now David, after a few years, becomes king. And they're in the Camelot of this time, Camelot being the highest time of the kingdom of Israel. But then David, at some point, takes a walk on the roof, and he sees a woman bathing, and he lusts after her, and he takes the steps toward not just having sex with her, committing adultery, but then setting up her husband's murder. his death, and thinking he gets away with it, but the baby dies. She had become pregnant, and the baby dies, and he also had been approached by Nathan, and he's approached by this prophet Nathan, who confronts him, and he uses a story, and he grabs David's heart, because David's one of those guys that can watch I would think he could even watch a chick flick and be one of those that's moved, you know. Hallmark, I think, would be too far for him, but I think for the most part, he would be a person that is pulled in by stories. He's moved by stories. And so as a result of that, he says, I have sinned. He owns it. God says to him, you're forgiven, but the sword will never depart from your house. And so the last time we were together, which is back in the spring, we had chapter 13, and chapter 13 is a bankrupt chapter. It really is. Amnon rapes his half-sister, Tamar, who is the full-blooded sister of a boy named Absalom. And Absalom plots the death of Amnon. He kills him, and then he runs. And he runs, he's of royal blood. David has not just one wife, he's got a few wives, and one of his wives is actually the daughter of a king in a place called Geshur. And Absalom runs to Grandpa's kingdom. And he's there in a time of banishment. He does not want the law to fall on him. And I bring all that to you to say that parenting is hard enough with life. It gets worse when we bring us into the mix. We sin. We have problems. And so sometimes it's nice to stop and watch how different people parent. So I want to bring you to an old classic, The Andy Griffith Show. All right, and so that you'll enjoy, and I want you to enjoy not just Andy talking to Opie, but somebody who never had kids named Barney Fife, who has no problem trying to help Andy along. Take a look.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for an opportunity to once again open your word, and thank you for using stories. You know what we're like, and you know how we learn best, and so thank you for that, God. I'm asking now as we're looking at this story that, Father, whatever you want for each of us to receive from it, because your spirit moves and illumines and gives us an understanding and even application that I would share. God, you're so much better at applying the word. So, Father, would you do that this morning in Jesus' name? Amen. Point number one, as you and I are working through this together is we see someone. We see someone. This chapter is almost the opposite of the prodigal son story. The prodigal son story, which rips our heart out and makes us ponder our kids and the love of a father toward their son or daughter. Take a look there with me at chapter 14 of 2 Samuel, beginning at verse 1. Now Joab, the son of Zerai, knew that the king's heart went out to Absalom. Zerai is the relative of David, and so Joab would be David's nephew, and Joab, his heart is seeing David's heart, and he looks at him and he says, I think I can fix some of this, what's going on. Because remember, now Absalom is away. And even though he's murdered one of David's other sons, and David has been in a time of mourning concerning that son, Amnon, he still loves he loves all of his kids. And so Joab sees that, and he knows that king's heart went out to Absalom. But this isn't necessarily a heart that went out to him as in, he's completely compassionate. He's completely forgiving. He's that kind of heart. It's a heart that is perplexed concerning what to do. You see, there's probably talk in the kingdom. He had already been seen as somebody that the kingdom looks at as he messed up big time when it came to Bathsheba. He gets away with something that other people would be stoned over. He has a situation here now. He's got this son that had raped a girl, and that son for years had gotten away with it until Absalom basically took the law into his hands and did something about that. What's happened in David's life, and this is why I'm constantly trying to beat the drum in my own life and into your life, is this. What will happen with sin in our lives is sin will make us sometimes rationalize how we will handle future events. You see, David feels like a hypocrite because of what he's done, and so there's times where his kids will do things, and instead of taking a stand, instead of owning that, yes, I did do that, because the kid could always bring up into your face, you know, you did this, and it's an acknowledgement by the parent, go, yeah, I did. And what I did was wrong. And we're not going to keep this cycle going. We're going to confront it and deal with it. And instead of it being the case, instead of David actually doing Barney Fife parenting or Barney Fife wisdom, which is nip it in the bud, he is one that will let it go and think that somehow that is going to, it's going to somehow work itself out. And sometimes that does happen. But more often than not, we need to get on something. We need to take care of it because it can grow. It can get bad. And that's what's happened with this situation. And so David's heart is messed up. And that's why God says, I don't want you to sin. I, as least amount of it as you can possibly do, try that to be the case so you don't put more and more in your backpack. And so Joab's watching his relative. He's watching his king, who he loves. He says, how can I resolve this? And so Joab is going to take a step to do something. And I hope you enjoy the story here because I think it's really well, obviously it's the word of God, but it's really well put together. Verse 2, and Joab sent to Tekoa. And Tekoa, if you remember, that's the home of Amos when we were working through that prophet Amos. He sends to Tekoa and he brought from there a wise woman and said to her, Basically, I want you to do some acting. Pretend to be a mourner and put on mourning garments. Okay? Do not anoint yourself with oil. So basically, don't put makeup on. But behave like a woman who has been mourning many days for the dead. Go up to the king and speak thus to him. So Joab put the words in her mouth. So you see what's happening here. He's creating a situation, a story, because Joab knows that David is moved by stories. I think after a while, you get to know people. You get to know this is the thing that works. Some of you young people, you're like, oh, we're way ahead of you in this one, all right? We know how to talk to which parent, how, what way, what motivates, what moves. Some of you are like that, a spouse that you after a while, you should be figuring some things out, and you know what communicates. Well, David is moved by stories, and what we're seeing as this is the case is they also know, Joab knows, that David, after he's being moved by a story, he will do the right thing. He will do the right thing. And so this is what's happened here. You see, two chapters earlier, David was moved because of Nathan's confrontation. The difference is that Joab was the one who set this up. God is the one who set up the past story. And so this lady is given a script. And I want you to understand, you see the descriptive word for this lady? She's a wise woman. So she's given a job to do. And you'll see as time goes by, she's doing it, and she's doing it very craftily. And she's putting it together in such a way that Joab can only put so many words into her mouth. She's got to know how to play off of this thing. She's got to improv. That's what's making her a wise woman. She's got this reputation. She's an actress. And so he's going to be moved, or we'll see that in a moment here. Point number two is we see strategy. We see strategy. Look at verse 4. When the woman of Tekoa came to the king, she fell on her face to the ground and paid homage and said, "Save me, O king." And the king said to her, "What is your trouble?" She answered, "Alas, I am a widow. My husband is dead. And your servant," she's talking about herself, "had two sons, and they quarreled with one another in the field. There was no one to separate them. And one struck the other and killed him. And now the whole clan has risen against your servant. And they say, 'Give up the man who struck his brother, that we may put him to death for the life of his brother whom he killed.' And so they would destroy the heir also. Thus they would quench my coal that is left and leave to my husband neither name nor remnant on the face of the earth." So in this story that Joab has put together, and Joab's smart enough to do this too. Joab knows that he probably isn't the best storyteller. So he hires somebody. He puts somebody into that position. And so this woman comes and she basically says, my husband is dead, and which would cause David's heart to go out because he was one that murdered and made that situation. All these things, by the way, because of what we bring, carry in our backpack, and usually, if we're caring, we remember, oh yeah, I can relate to that. I've got a story that comes alongside that relates to that. And then she mentions two sons. Oh, I had two sons, and one killed another. And they got into a fight. And it looks like it was a fight that it was an accident. He never meant to do this. And now the rest of the family wants to kill the only remaining son. So a bunch of different things would come to mind. Maybe the story of Cain and Abel back in Genesis 4. And I want you to know that David would have known that story because David studied. He knew the law. He wrote Psalms. saying, I love your law. And so he would know that story. And so he's going, okay, what would God have done? Well, God even gave to the guilty party. Remember what God did for Cain? He put a mark on him so that he could be kept from being killed. So what would be the most godlike thing? And this is David's thinking. I want to be godly even after I've messed up. Maybe that's what she's going for. Maybe that's what Joab is going for. He wants him to be like God. You see all that's tied into it. And you do know in the Jewish culture, we've talked about this before when we were back in dealing with the law, they had cities of refuge. Remember cities of refuge? Somebody would kill somebody accidentally, and they could run to that place, and nobody could kill them. And if by rules, by law, it was figured actually it wasn't by accident, then there would be the avenger of blood, and usually that was a family member, or the family member would basically hire a hitman and take him out. You'd go, man, there's a lot of mafia in the Bible, okay? It's just people. It's just, that's nothing new. There's nothing new under the sun. And so she's scared about this. And she even uses a picture that I think is a beautiful picture. She says, I have that he would take my coal. And some of you may be sitting here, you do know that brothers do fight. Am I telling you anything? I mean, even sisters fight. My wife so happens to have her sisters here with her today. I told her I'd tell this story. I haven't told the sisters this yet. But there was a time where they were in the living room watching TV, and the two older sisters were watching something just like All My Children. And Kim, my wife, wanted to watch Underdog, something with depth. How do I get my way? So Kim goes, here's what I will do. And she took her arm and she bit her arm. And then she ran to her mom and said, they bit my arm. And she came in. She said, I can't believe she bit her own arm. Nobody would bite their own arm. They were sent away and she watched Underdog. So it even happens with sisters. I know I owe you guys money that I used you in the illustration. But this happens in families. It's just the deal. It's just how it plays out. And so David isn't like, I can't believe that would happen with a son. It's a reality. Verse 9. Actually, verse 8. Then the king said to the woman, go to your house, and I will give orders concerning you. Now, if you hear that, it's like, you're not giving me, he's definitely not giving her what Joab would want. And she's smart enough, she's a wise woman, she knows I gotta get more than that. I think I told you all the story of when I got arrested. Some of you are like, look at that. There are some of you like, I'm kind of losing you, and then the heads went up. I like the Bible, but I want to hear this one, all right? What had happened was my son had driven my car, and he got stopped, nothing major league, okay, he got stopped, but he didn't have in the car proof of insurance. And the policeman actually in Warrenton, they allowed him to, you know, okay, we'll get that to my office, and for whatever reason, that was the case. So I went over to the building to give them the sheet of paper that had proof of insurance. And the lady was just busy doing stuff, and she's sitting there at the desk, and she takes it, and she just slaps it on a bunch of papers. And in my mind, I'm going, now that will make it to where it needs to go, right? But I didn't say that, and I want to encourage you, ask that. Because later, I'm driving, and over at, I'm driving on 64, I think, toward like Chesterfield, and I get pulled over, and they've got a warrant for my arrest. And it was so, I was wanting to be respectful to the policeman. I get back, cuffed on the highway. By the way, I told the story to the church that next Sunday because I'm like, if somebody saw me, you know. And then they put me in the clink over in St. Peter's. And so I'm in there, and I call my wife, and I go, I'm in jail. And then a million went thoughts through her mind, you know. So, and then ultimately, my wife paid the bail. It was nice of her. All right. And so ultimately, I went to the courthouse and they paid me back because I brought the proof of insurance. Here's my point. You think you're doing things sometimes to cover bases, and you're not. You have to be adamant about it sometimes. This lady's adamant. She's not just, he goes, I'll take care of this. David goes, I'll take care of this. She's like, no, that's not enough. Look at verse 9. And the woman of Tekoa said to the king, on me be the guilt, my lord the king, and my father's house. Let the king and his throne be guiltless. So she's saying, I know that you're bending the rules in this matter, and I know that there will be people, because there may be people that are like, well, he should be put to death. And so he's saying, I'll take care of this. And she goes, no, I need more. I need more from you. Look at verse 10. The king said, if anyone says anything to you, bring it to me, and he shall never touch you again. So he's basically saying, if anyone bothers you, bring them here, and they won't bother you again, David says. But she's not worried about herself. Now, in the story, this is all pretend, but she's not, and we know that as parents, don't we? There's times where our kids are going through stuff that we're like, I'd rather have it than them. And so this is where she's at. She's going, it's not her situation that's the situation. It's that her son could die. Verse 11 here. Then she said, I love how she keeps doing it, please let the king invoke the Lord your God. So she wants him to put God's name on this thing because she knows David will do the right thing. Please let the king invoke the Lord your God, that the avenger of blood kill no more and my son be not destroyed. And then he said this, as the Lord lives, not one hair of your son shall fall to the ground. And in a moment, a little bit, as we keep working through, the hair is going to show up again. So there's a picture there, not one hair. So he's giving a promise, and he's pointing that to God. It's not just his word. It's tied to God. And then the woman said, so then she's happy because it's like I fulfilled what I needed to from Joab. And you notice she's smart because he could not have put every word into her mouth. She knew how to play off this thing. She's good at improv. But then here's the rub. Then the woman said, please let your servant speak a word to my lord the king. And he said, speak. Yeah, I wonder how he's feeling at this point. When am I done with this woman? You know, it's like, speak. And the woman said, why then have you planned such a thing against the people of God? For in giving this decision, the king convicts himself, inasmuch as the king does not bring his banished one home again. So she's basically saying, so you'd give to me good news concerning your kid, my kid, but your kid is in this situation and you're not willing to do it for him? And this has ramifications for the kingdom. People are talking right now, King David. People are talking. When's he going to deal with this? There's some talking like, when is he going to deal with Absalom? Some would be talking, Absalom wasn't in the wrong. What happened with his half-brother was, it should have been dealt with by you. And so there might be factions growing. We don't know all that's involved. You know politics. I mean, David here, he's dealing with Hunter, Absalom. Never happens with kids in the leadership. I'll keep going. But so she says that, and then she says, we must all die. We're like water spilled on the ground, which cannot be gathered up again. But God will not take away life, and he devises means so that the banished one will not remain an outcast. Now, I want you to look at that last verse, and I want you to see this woman is proclaiming truth. This is gospel. Please take this verse in and receive it, not just as part of this story, but it's what God does for us. Let me read it to you again. We're all going to die. We must all die. We are like water spilled in the ground, which can't be gathered. Amnon's dead. But now we have to deal with the issues that we are at hand right now. And this is the core issue. You'll even have this as you're witnessing to people. There'll be times where you're sharing truth with someone and they'll start bringing up stuff that's all over the map. And this lady cuts right to the quick. She says this, but God will not take away life. God's about bringing life. And he devises means so that the banished one will not remain an outcast. Isn't that the gospel? That's the work of God. I want to bring people to myself. I'm going to devise means. And he devised it. He brought his son into the world to be condemned so that we wouldn't be condemned. God is all about bringing banished ones back. I'm so glad she didn't put the word name Absalom in there. Said the banished one, because you and I, before we came into Christ, we were the banished ones. We were apart. Some of our own choices. And so God is calling us to himself. He's saying, I want to bring you back home. Verse 15, now I have come to say this to my... This woman's got guts. Now I have come to say this to my Lord the king, because the people have made me afraid, and your servant thought, I will speak to the king. It may be that the king will perform the request of his servant. For the king will hear and deliver his servant from the hand of the man who would destroy me and my son together from the heritage of God. Isn't it interesting? She moves from that story, which is pretend. She gets the thing where she admonishes him. And then she moves effortlessly back into the story again. I don't know if at this point David knows that this is just a story. But she's saying, God wants you to do for your son what you would have done for my son. And your servant thought, the word of my Lord the king will set me at rest. For my Lord, and look at how she puts this at him, my Lord the king is like the angel of God, or the messenger of God, some of your translations would say, to discern good and evil. So she knows what he's done. She knows he's made mistakes. But she's putting before him, aren't you going to do the right thing? The Lord your God be with you. And that's the thing that would make David successful. You see him in those early chapters of 1 Samuel. Why was David so successful? The Lord was with him. And even more important is David was aligning himself with the Lord. And every time that David was having problems is when he was stepping outside of that. That's why God is saying to you and me constantly, I want you to be people that follow me. I want you to be people that obey me, that walk with me, that desire to be obedient to what I've called you. What a beautiful picture of the gospel. And then I like David's question to her. Look at this. Then the king answered the woman, do not hide from me anything I ask. And now the woman says, and the woman said, let my lord the king speak. So he told her, speak. Now she's going, he goes, I want to ask you something, and you got to be honest with me. And she goes, speak. The king said, is the hand of Joab in all this? Like, he probably had Joab earlier trying to engineer some change. You ever notice that when something happens and you go, A few years back here, Grace Bible Church, it lined up on a Sunday. April Fool's Day was on a Sunday. And I'm up here and doing my thing, and I get up to speak, and I look out, and all of you guys that usually sit over here were over here. And all of you were here, were here. And I was like, were the hands of Dishman and Etcher, did they have anything to do with this? And everybody was like, nah, yes, they are the evil ones that do these kind of things. Okay. Because you know After a while, you get to know people. You understand how they do things. And so he's not fooled by this. He goes, Joab's put you up to this. Okay, look at verse 20, or just 19 again. The king says, the hand of Joab with all this, the woman answered and said, as surely as you live, my lord the king, one cannot turn to the right hand or to the left from anything that my lord the king has said. It was your servant Joab who commanded me. It was he who put all these words in the mouth of your servant, which isn't true. You think about it. He would have to know everything about how David would respond. This woman had something to do with it. She just knew what she had to get accomplished. In order, look at this. This is what we do sometimes. In order to change the course of things, your servant Joab did this. Isn't that what our heart is like sometimes as parents? We see something going on and we want to change the course in a good way. I could keep naming scenarios, but you know that. There's something in us sometimes that we see something heading a certain direction, and we want to change the course of it. And so this is Joab's heart. He means well, but Joab's the one who sent this woman. God sent Nathan. And we need to understand, when I'm moving, even if we have the best of intentions, Father, please help this to be what you desire, what you want. And I think God wants reconciliation here. But my Lord, and there she goes again, but my Lord has wisdom like the wisdom of the angel of God to know all things that are on the earth. And so she can be flattering. She's saying truth because David has been that person over the years. And he needs to be that person. Again, last point. We see summons. And so we see this dramatic woman, this woman of drama, exit stage left. Okay, she's out now. And then the king says to Joab, behold, now I grant this. Go, look at how he titles his son, bring back the young man Absalom. And Joab fell on his face to the ground and paid homage and blessed the king. And Joab said, today your servant knows that I have found favor in your sight, my lord the king, in that the king has granted the request of his servant. So Joab's happy. It's worked out. He's saying, oh, I'm bringing him back. And why is he so committed? Why is Joab so committed to this? Part of it may be he loves David, and it's a relative, and he sees this, and the tension's killing him. Part of it may be he sinned by killing somebody. Remember he killed Abner? He had called Abner over, and he stuck him with a knife there and killed him. And then how David treated him, David made him part of the ceremony and had him march out front, and he just was humbled in so many ways. And so there might be a part of Joab that's like, I hate that this is happening because I hated when it happened to me. Isn't it interesting when we've sinned a certain way, when we've messed up, I would hope that we'd be some of the most humble people. You ever have that where something you did looks like a lot like somebody and your heart immediately goes out to them and other people wouldn't understand it because they didn't do that thing, but your heart goes out. And that's what I think is the calling in our lives, that sinners would be called back to the Lord because of where we've messed up, where we've sinned. And so I think Joab's heart is one where he wants this. And so he's happy. You see him here. He's happy. But look at verse 22. So Joab arose and went to Geshur and brought Absalom to Jerusalem. And I want you to notice verse 24. And the king said, let him dwell apart in his own house. He is not to come into my presence. So Absalom lived apart in his own house and did not come into the king's presence. So he says, okay, I'll do this, but I don't want to see him. See how it's the opposite of the prodigal son story? It's one where there's still, I'm not happy with what happened. He's got the tension of I don't know what to do about this. I've messed up in my own private life. I've also how I dealt with this politically. All those different things that are going through his mind as a leader. So he's in a frustrating place. verse 25. Now in all Israel, I want you, this is a side thing. This is one of those things that we start to see something. Now in all Israel, there was no one so much to be praised for his handsome appearance as Absalom. Look at this description. From the sole of his foot to the crown of his head, there was no blemish in him. My man was good looking. Handsome. He's the type that when he walked in a room, all the girls are like, I know I'm married to you. I know I'm married to you. But wow. All right. This is something, I want you to know this description. I know nothing about this, all right? This hasn't been part of my life. In fact, I'll see these guys with their nice hair, and I'm bitter and angry. And they walk in, I'm having fun. And somebody else, they walk in the room, and the girls are like, hey, I was talking to you. Absalom, look at how much, you know, one verse is said about him. No depth of character. In fact, look at how minimally he is dealing with character issues. This next part. So no blemish. Verse 26. And when he cut the hair of his head, and then look at this, parentheses, for at the end of every year he used to cut it. When it was heavy on him. Oh. He cut it. And he weighed the hair of his head, 200 shekels by the king's weight. 4 to 5 pounds of hair. Yeah. That's never been an issue. Never. It's like, you know, the Fabio thing. Or, you know, the covers of the Harlequin romance. But just get that picture. So this is the depth of what we're reading about this guy. His hair, weighing his, who does this? Especially as a guy who does this. And so don't tell me. And I'll say, oh, you, because I know some of you guys, you never have met a mirror you don't like. You'll watch him and you go, oh, you really like yourself. This is Absalom. Let's keep going. They were born to Absalom 3 sons and 1 daughter whose name was Tamar, so he names it after his sister who had been raped. She was a beautiful woman. So Absalom lived 2 full years in Jerusalem without coming into the king's presence. So 3 years away in Geshur, 2 years, 5 years goes by. Dad's not talking to him. Then Absalom sent for Joab to send him to the king, but Joab would not come to him. And he sent a second time, but Joab would not come. Then he said to his servants, look at this guy. He's like, okay, you ain't going to listen to me? This is the depth of this person's character. See, Joab's field next to mine. He has barley there. Go and set it on fire. Now, don't use this. Okay, if you're trying to get your parents' attention, okay, don't do this, all right? This is the kind of person we're dealing with. He sets it on fire. Then, verse 31, then Joab arose and went to Absalom at his house and said to him, why have your servants set my field on fire? Like, seriously, you don't know? And he says, basically, Absalom, I could translate, you don't answer my calls, okay? Absalom answered Joab, behold, I sent word to you. Come here that I may send you to the king to ask, why have I come from Geshur? It would be better for me to be there still. God wants us to be people that if we're going to do forgiveness, if we're going to do reconciliation, do it. Don't keep holding stuff in your back pocket. If you're going to forgive somebody, forgive them. Now therefore, let me go into the presence of the king. And if there is guilt in me, let him put me to death. There is guilt, but he knows his dad. Then Joab went to the king and told him, and he summoned Absalom. So he came to the king, and I want you to notice each time, it's not dad, it's not father, it's not even David. You see the king, the king, the king, the king. This relationship has become political, and God wants us to be familial. Then Joab went to the king and told him. He summoned Absalom. So he came to the king and bowed himself in his face to the ground before the king. And the king kissed Absalom. God is calling on you and me, though. What kind of kiss is this? What kind of kiss is this? We'll see. It's not necessarily the kiss that it ought to be. There needs to be forgiveness. This is how God forgives. Psalm 103, verse 12. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. And Jesus, who is the better king, he tells a story. You want to hear a story? And I got a story about two sons too. And you know the story. And at a certain point, the son who had been living afar off, a self-banishment, I wish you were dead, give me my inheritance. And instead of not forgiving, he's a forgiving father who's constantly looking down the road, and he sees his son come, and look at this kiss. And he arose and came to his father, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. That's a different kind of kiss. And God's heart and desire for us with one another is to have a kiss looking to forgive, looking to reconcile. Obviously, we would hope that Absalom came and he had a heart of repentance, but we don't know completely what was going on in his heart. We can't sometimes. But God is calling us home, and he may be here today. You may be here today, and he's once again calling you home. And you think he's going to be Davidic, and I mean that in a bad way, that he's got something he's going to hold in his pocket toward you. God is a God of forgiveness, of reconciliation. He's looking for sinners to come home. Jesus is from the line of David, and he's perfect. And that's our Savior, and that's who we worship. I'm inviting you. I'll invite every Sunday, I hope. I'm inviting you to get to know God through his Son, Jesus Christ, who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for your gracious, gracious patience. And I'm asking God, you're constantly with these stories, you're building a case. You're building a case to prove love over and over again. Even with how great David was, he was so great. He was the messenger of God. He's like an angel of God, but he's not God. And so, Father, thank you that your Son came into the world to forgive sinners, to build a relationship, to build a bridge between us and you. And that bridge was down. There was sin. There was death in between. And you, through the cross, made it possible for us to know you. So thank you for that. Father, do your work. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you take your hymnals?